And it was a call to follow me, the Lord said, into the unknown. Because this is where the path of true faith will lead us. And he brought many examples to me in Scripture of how the men and women of faith that went on to fulfill God's purpose and plan and destiny in their time, in their generation, were because they were willing to follow God into the unknown, the things that they knew not. And of course, the greatest example is in Jesus and his great work of salvation, which was achieved on the basis of plunging into the darkness of what to him was totally and utterly the unknown, as he yielded himself into the hands of man. Okay, this was, God was holy and all light, in him was no darkness. And he yielded himself into the hands of Satan, death, hell, and the grave. I don't believe when he descended into the heart of the earth that he had ever truly been there. He, being the Son of God, he had no idea what the how the sin of the world felt to be laid on him. It was totally unknown what he would experience when his Father turned his back on him. But yet he rose up out of all of these unknown factors, even though the prophecies were there, sent by God, aided by the angels, okay? What brought the salvation to the world? What brought forth the new creature in Christ, which is the bride elect, was Jesus' willingness to plunge into the darkness of absolute unknown uncertainties. And this is the greatest template of we as the warrior bride, as the faith warriors in the 21st century, as he calls us to follow him in this hour into the uncertainties, into the darkness of the unknown. And he gave me an example of the Hebrews in the wilderness after the spies came back and spying out the land. And they were before Moses and all the people, and they were giving a report, because this was, they already knew this was God's plan. This was their destiny. This is what God had delivered them from bondage. He had gave them his law, his prophecies, his miracles, his fire by night and his pillar of cloud by day. But he had a plan and a destiny for them, and that was to take them across the Jordan and on into the promised land, because God had purposes beyond where they were in that moment in time that he had prepared them for. And I heard the Holy Spirit say it wasn't a matter that these people were sinners, that they were sinful, because they had the blood of the lambs and the goats, which God accepted as types of Christ's sacrifice to cover their sin. The blood was taken into the Holy of Holies. That Moses stood in the gap for them as a type of Christ. It wasn't a matter of whether God could use them. Okay, he prepared them to use them. But when the spies came back, the ball was in their court. For all the mighty acts and works that God had done, truly the ball was in their court. And what was it that kept them from going in but uncertainty? It was the fear of the unknown. They kept seizing on all the negative comments about what would happen. It was the what if, the what if, and the what if. And in all of the places in Scripture, even when God came through Abraham's dwelling on his way to Sodom and Gomorrah, even in the time of Noah preparing the ark in the day of judgment, I have never read an account of God being so angry and full of wrath towards a generation as he was, that generation of Hebrews, that he was preparing to take in to the promised land or into his plan and purpose. And Moses had to intercede to keep them from being just utterly destroyed. You need to read that account in the Old Testament, in Exodus, of how Moses had to intervene to keep God from just wiping out that generation, because it would be such a terrible testimony to the heathens that they're going in, that they're going into the land to conquer, tear down their false gods and set up the true God. But the thing that angered God, and I believe the Holy Spirit said to me, this is the thing that's angering God with his church today, with the bride of Christ, bride elect today. That generation of Hebrews stopped God in his tracks. That generation under Moses stopped God Almighty, who parted the Red Sea, who created the heavens and the earth, who brought them forth out of the Egyptian bondage with a strong hand, who fed them with the manna from heaven and water out of the rock, who led them as a shepherd leads his sheep, who spoke his words, who gave them his law. They stopped that God in his tracks. And I feel the Holy Spirit is calling us out. Loose thyself from thy bands, O captive daughter of Zion. Jesus is saying, follow me into the unknown. Because that's where your path will unfold before you. Jesus couldn't conquer from heaven. He couldn't conquer from staying, avoiding the cross. He couldn't conquer, become more than a conqueror by refusing to die. You know, when Jesus said no to his flesh, I believe that's when the devils begin to tremble. When he said yes to God, I'm willing to go into the complete unknown, uncharted territory. And I'm reminded of so many other examples. Abraham went out not knowing where he was going. Paul, the Holy Spirit had told him he was going to go to Rome and appeal to Caesar. But it wasn't until he was within the process of his journey on the ship that he knew that a deadly storm was coming that would destroy him and the crew. And that he was assured by the angel that in spite of the uncertainties and the unknown of a ship tossed at sea in horrible storm conditions, if Paul would believe and hold steady, that his God would get him to promise. And not only him, but all on that ship. And I don't know what Paul must have thought when the angel assured him that he wasn't going to die. If he thought that a chariot was going to swing down and pick him and the crew up and skim across the waters to shore. But the ship actually crashed on the rocks and they all had to swim for their life. I mean, I like to picture the great apostle Paul swimming for his life. How many of us have been in that situation? But could he have been any more in God's will, perfect will, as he was in that very moment? And many came on broken pieces and timbers from the ship, but they all made it safely to land. And I believe that the church in this hour of the 21st century is sitting in the dust with their hands bound. And I just made a new video called The Warrior Bride that's based on the allegory of the Song of Solomon between the bride elect and the bridegroom, which is the church, in which is Jesus Christ. And it's calling us forth. We're sitting in the dust with our hands bound. And we're only doing that because we're afraid of the unknown. And we live in an hour like no other hour on the face of the earth. We have the media, we have the abilities to propagate the gospel like no other generation. There's never been this many people on the face of the earth. We can cast our nets on the other side 24/7 and bring up haul after haul after haul. And praise God, I appeal to those who believe that you will get on your face before God and say, I repent if I have stopped you in your tracks in my life and my ministry through my doubt and unbelief of the unknown men suffering. But God, I rededicate, I can recommit myself to a life of faith, to follow you by faith. I take up my cross to follow you, Jesus, to where you're going in this hour, in this generation. I don't want to be left as those who wandered in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights. I don't want to just have my physical needs met or my shoes not wearing out. A lot of believers have settled for that. They've become so materialistic oriented and self-oriented and needs oriented that they'll settle for that. They're comfortable in that. But are we going to cross the Jordan with Joshua and Caleb? That last soul of that last generation died, but that first generation died. And the day finally came for those who stood in faith to rise up and follow God across the Jordan into the Promised Land. We have an amazing Promised Land before us of ministry and of evangelization in the South.